advocate and more vocal American.
I'm becoming hopeful.
I am becoming fearless.
The girl who's going to reach her dream.
I am becoming my mother.
I am becoming a doctor. And if that doesn't work out, I will try to be an NBA star.
I am becoming a teacher.
A Lego expert.
And a mathematician.
A musician.
A cranial facial plastic surgeon.
I am becoming the queen.
Also, I am becoming a better dancer. Hey!
Oh! I am proudly becoming a pilot in the United States Air Force.
I am becoming more gentle with myself.
I'm becoming more aware.
A young adult.
A grown woman.
A whole human being.
And most importantly, a strong, independent woman.
A strong Black woman.
I am becoming my best self. Maybe I'm the next Oprah.
Another Michelle Obama, actually.
I'm becoming my favorite version of myself.
More myself.
The best version of myself.
I am becoming more than I expected.
The full Gwyneth Paltrow.
I am becoming all that God created me to be.
I'm becoming me.
Great to see you all here tonight. I'm thrilled to be here to kick off tonight's Michelle Obama's Becoming Tour, which launched in Chicago. I gotta say, I haven't been to the United Center since we had our final goodbye to the Oprah show 7 years ago right here. And the world has changed so much since then. I know some, right? So many people are feeling uneasy, disrupted, just downright scared, afraid of the impending darkness. I know that, but this is what I also know, that you all being here tonight is a testament to the light. That's what tonight is. Because each of you here is here because you were inspired by one woman's story. And then you bought a ticket. You did whatever you could to get this ticket. Y'all been working on the tickets. You got a sitter. How many of you got the sitter waiting at home? Yep. You put on your best going out, I'm gonna meet Michelle clothes. You took the train, some of you took the train because you didn't want to deal with the traffic. Hello, train people. You don't want to deal with the traffic and the parking, and then a lot of you said, I'm gonna deal with the parking because it's Michelle Obama. And I know you got the Michelle Obama ticket, and when you got it, you said, now who deserves to come with me? You did it. So you said, who's that with you right now? Who's that? You brought your sister. People came in with their sisters, their friends, their cousins. I see a few woke men in here. My best friend Gail was here earlier today interviewing Mrs. Obama for CBS This Morning in the Morning. And she wanted to stay because she goes, I want to see Michelle. I go, you just saw Michelle. I want to know how many of you are here with your Gail. You came here with your Gail. We're glad to have you all here. And I want to just say that one of the most remarkable stories I have ever witnessed is the becoming of Michelle Obama. So, remember this? Last week, it was exactly 10 years ago when it felt like the whole city of Chicago was down on the lakefront, Grant Park. Who was there with me that night? Who was that? crying my eyelashes off on some stranger's shoulder. And together we got to witness one of the greatest, most transcendent moments in our country. Yes. When Barack Obama was elected President of the United States. And right there by his side, like you've been by his side, was his accomplished, smart, and gorgeous wife, Michelle, and their two adorable, continuing to be even more adorable daughters. It was an achievement that so many people never even thought that they would see in their lifetime. So let's take a look at how Michelle LaVon Robinson from the South Side grew up to become our beloved, awe-inspiring First Lady of the United States. Watch this.
Being willing to know and hear others. This, for me, is how we become.
She served our country as the 44th First Lady of the United States. She did that with style, she did it with grace, and a big old open heart. She made us always feel like the White House was really our house, the people's house. She is your hometown girl from the South Side of Chicago. You didn't need it, but okay. Everybody was gonna buy the book anyway, so I understand. Thank you. This is the truth though. Anytime you're looking at life from the outside in, it always looks like life is better over there, out there, up there. And you and your father used to do with the family what my father used to do in the Disney Quarter. Drive around.
Take that aspirational ride.
Take that aspirational ride. Particularly on Sunday.
Yeah, uh-huh.
Looking at other rich people's houses.
Mm-hmm.
White people.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And the truth is,
and other people.
New people were coming into the White House. And now we know, we saw the Robin Roberts special that you, and you even had stopped trying to smile. Okay. So we see you getting on the helicopter, and I thought this, I always think in that moment when you're getting on the helicopter, I want to know what that helicopter ride is like. So when you got on the helicopter, did you think, free at last? Free at last? Or did you, or was it bittersweet, or what was it?
Yeah, it was that whole day was a trip, first of all, for so many reasons, because also I want to, the transition in and out of the house, the whole transition process is crazy, right? One day you're a normal family, an election happens, you're president-elect, and your life changes instantly. It's like we're shot out of a cannon. And our house in Chicago feels like a bomb went off in it, like everything stopped. You know, we go back, I still have the seasonings that were there 10 years ago. You know, the kids' beds are still the same. We didn't have time to like adjust to it. So the transition in is amazingly quick. And the transition out feels just as quick because we've lived in a place for 8 years and now we have to move and go. And the transition happens when the president-elect takes the oath of office at the Capitol, and their staffs can't get into the White House. You can't do anything in that house until the president-elect becomes the president. And the minute that happens at the Capitol, moving trucks are moving in,
bringing their furniture in and taking our furniture out, all within hours of that parade. The parade is kind of like to give us moving time. It's just sort of like, keep marching. Keep on marching. Go around one more time. Walk a little more slowly. We're still making your bed.
Yeah. They're getting the sofas out.
Yeah. So they clean the sofas, put wallpaper up, paint. It is miraculous. So what was happening on our last day was that Sasha's and Malia's friends, who had grown up in the White House, came to me that night and was like, we want a sleepover. And I'm like, what? You want a sleepover? Yeah, we're going to miss being here. We want our last breakfast. Because you can get what you want to eat at the White House. So all those little girls were like, I think I'll have the fried chicken biscuit and I'm going to have the waffle. So this is what, we're trying to move and we've got like eight girls, little girls with their teddy bears and their blankets and they're sleeping over and then they wake up and I got to get them out. It's like, come on, wake up. The Trumps are coming. You got to get up. Get out. You know? So in the process, trying to get my hair done and zipping my dress. I'm like, wake up, get out. And they're crying. They're literally, they're crying. It's like, I'm gonna miss you too, baby. I'll see you tomorrow. We're not going anywhere. So there are tears going down the elevator and we're pushing them down like the back elevator. You know, so the babies are in the back elevator. I don't know how they were getting out, where their parents were picking them up. This is on the day, minutes before they're coming. And there are tears and there's crying and the staff is crying and I'm trying not to cry because I said if I walk out there crying, they're gonna swear I'm crying for a different reason. Yeah. Like, we have got to get it together. So it was a very emotional day. And then we go through the inauguration where I talk about how the optics on the stage were very different from the optics of our inauguration.
Yeah. You know,
we sat on that stage and looked around the stage. There was diversity. There were men and women and people of color and veterans and Pacific Airmen. There was a representation of America. And what struck me was when I sat on that stage, I saw sameness. And that was the first time it struck me that this is gonna be different. You know, and then I listened to the speech and I said, this is gonna be really different. And my heart sunk. And that day was, that moment made it harder. So
you did start out kind of with the face, you know, with your pleasant.
Yes, like, transition. I mean, what we learned from the Bushes was that our job as the former is to make the transition as easy as possible, to be on the ready. So we had been preparing for
hours.
The section of the book when I talk to my high school counselor, I've had a meeting with her. I say, I'm not sure, she said, giving me a perfunctory, patronizing smile, that you're Princeton material. Her judgment was as swift as it was dismissive, probably based on a quick glance calculus involving my grades and test scores. That, as I've said, failure is a feeling long before it's an actual result. And for me, it felt like that's exactly what she was planting, a suggestion of failure long before I even tried to succeed. She was telling me to lower my sights, which was the absolute reverse of every last thing my parents had ever told me. But 3 years of keeping up with the ambitious kids at Whitney Young had taught me that I was something more. I wasn't gonna let one person's opinion dislodge everything I thought I knew about myself. I've been lucky enough now in my life to meet all sorts of extraordinary and accomplished people, world leaders, inventors, musicians, astronauts, athletes, professors, entrepreneurs, artists, writers, pioneering doctors, researchers. Some, though not enough of them, are women. Some, though not enough, are black or of color. What I've learned is this. All of them have had doubters, Some continue to have roaring, stadium-sized collections of critics and naysayers who will shout, "I told you so," at every little misstep or mistake. The noise doesn't go away. But the most successful people I know have figured out how to live with it, to lean on the people who believe in them, and to push onward with their goals. That day, I left the college counselor's office at Whitney Young, and I was fuming, my ego bruised more than anything. My only thought in the moment was, "I'll show you."
Gosh, there's so many prayers, but here this is the thing. Writing this book, having the opportunity to reflect on one's life is a luxury. You know, people don't get to write books, they don't get the time to do it, they don't get the time to reflect, but it was absolutely healing for me to be able to look on my life and sort of figure out how all these little stories that seem meaningless, like my relationship with my Aunt Robbie,